deficit. We're borrowing a little over $2 million every minute. I mean, that means we'll borrow $50 million, you know, the next 25 minutes. It's just extraordinary where we are. You've been vocal in your support for earmarks. We haven't done earmarks around here for a while when the Republicans were in charge. I think maybe it's important that we review where some of these earmarks have been going in the past. Most people remember the Bridge to Nowhere. This was $400 million on a bridge and road to nowhere. It served about 50 people in Alaska. It was lampooned for years. There was also $350 million we spent on an A3 rocket test stand in a senator's home state. It was completed in 2014, 4 years after the program it was designed to be used for was shuttered. Earmarks don't have a great history in our country. We spent $1 million on a former residence of Thomas Stone, a marginal historical figure who argued for reconciliation with the British. Before signing the Declaration of Independence, the house was bought in exchange for a Maryland congressman's vote on a national parks bill. This is what would happen in the past. If they wanted you to vote for something, they say, well, was your grandmother prominent in her community? We'll do grandmother's museum for you. That literally was happening under earmarks. $1 million was spent on exhibits and films for the Woodstock Museum. Now, some of these things got put in, and then someone finally had some sense and took them back out. This one never got built, fortunately. $50 million on a 4.5-acre indoor tropical rainforest in Iowa that was never built but was stuck in by a senator and then, fortunately, was removed. This is sort of the history of earmarks. They're sort of the worst of what government represents. And so I'm troubled that this is something you've voiced support for. There was $22 million put in a secret DOD program to investigate UFO sightings. This was one of Senator Reid's passions. I don't think we have to go further into the discussion of whether or not that's a good use of taxpayer money. $50,000 to the Detroit Institute of Bagels. There's one we really think we need to spend some money on. $90,000 to create audio tours of the National Cowgirl Museum and Hall of Fame. $500,000 to the Teapot Hall of Fame, which closed before construction was completed. $500,000 to travel for high school exchange programs between the Philadelphia and the Virgin Islands. So, I mean, the history of earmarks is not one of our, you know, putting our best foot forward. So I worry that you would go to OMB and this is a philosophy that you would bring there because you've publicly advocated for these. In the most recent bill, we have $140 million for Congressman Pelosi's, a tunnel in her district. We have $1.5 million in it for Senator Schumer for a bridge in his state. So I think that we really need to look long and hard at this. At the peak of earmarking in 2006, members of Congress added nearly 10,000 pet projects, costing the taxpayer nearly $29 billion. During a 10-year period, the earmarks rose in 1996 from about 1,000 to 14,000. I think we finally had one transportation bill that had 6,000 earmarks on one transportation bill. And there literally was stuff named after people's grandmothers or somebody prominent in their district. They'd say, oh, we'll do a museum for them. Studies estimated that for every dollar companies spent lobbying, they bought $28 in earmarks. At one point, 60% of the House Armed Services Committee members were channeling earmarks to campaign contributors. When they did a reform and they said you had to put your name and attach your name to the earmark you put on to sort of shame people into this, they found that of the 81 House and Senate appropriators who made up 15% of Congress, they were responsible for 51% of the earmarks and 61% of the money spent. So I guess considering where we are in the debt, I'd like to hear, you know, why you think it would be a good idea to go back to earmarks.
Senator, thank you. Thank you for the question and opportunity to talk about this issue. The first commentary I have is the Constitution is very clear about who gets to appropriate, and it's Congress out of the three equal branches. So it will be your decision, congressional decision, House and Senate, on whether how you spend federal dollars, if confirmed. I think it would be my role at OMB to implement what you have passed. So I certainly appreciate any past comments I may have made. I'm a staffer, so I doubt I've made many public comments. As you have staff, our bosses tend to make comments. But I believe there is going to be a lively debate about how you choose, as the Constitution dictates. And I certainly hope to be confirmed. And on matters of the budget, if technical assistance is needed, if confirmed at OMB, we will be happy to provide that. But it is Congress's role to spend dollars.
You're right. And Congress will make the decision, not you. Do you favor earmarks? Do you think they're a good idea?
I certainly think the word earmarks has taken on, one definition. I think we earmark now. I think how do you fund the Army Corps or highway projects without earmarking? They're in a place, and they cost money. So there are some federal programs that are earmarks by the very definition of being directed, being in someone's district or state.
I guess the difference is this. So, for example, when Robert Byrd was here, he paved about every inch of West Virginia because he had the power to do it and he'd been here forever. I've got a bridge that's needed to be fixed and had to have repairs, and we had people lined up for 10 miles on either side of it, but I don't think it'd be right for me to fix this one bridge in there ahead of others. I think what would be appropriate is we lay out the rules on which bridges should be fixed. So you're right, Congress has an obligation. We shouldn't just send it to the president, who could then earmark it, which would be a mistake. We should say bridges that have the most traffic, are the oldest, have had the most repairs. We should set the rules for then the Department of Transportation, and then ultimately, you'd think the decision would be made by engineers, but that's not the history of earmarks. The history of earmarks is the longer you've been here, the more stuff you get. And it's true on both sides of the aisle, Republican and Democrat, the longer you're here, the more stuff you get under the earmark regime. And there has been a little bit less of that. So, but I think it's a real mistake to advocate for earmarks and to be too blasé about it, because I think, our country really is suffering under a great burden of debt, and OMB has some oversight in that. So being in favor of earmarks to me is not a good thing.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Romney. You are recognized for your questions.
Mr. Chairman, Tom Carper here. Do you know where I am in the queue, please?
Senator Carper, we've got Senator Romney. There are others that are going to be coming that are ahead of Senator Romney that aren't here yet, but you are after him. You're 1, 2, 3, 4 on the list after Senator Romney, but there are 1, 2, 3 that may arrive that are ahead of Senator Romney. So maybe a few. We'll let you know when we're